Hi, this is Karin Zissis with ASCOA Online. He was in a psychiatric hospital for most of his life and never considered himself an artist, nor did he aspire to have his work shown in a museum. Still, Heitor Villa-Lobos is considered one of the greatest influencers of Latin American art in the 20th century. Bispo, an Afro-Brazilian artist, believed that the 1,000 pieces he produced were a mandate of God that fulfilled a mission to recreate the universe stemming from hallucinations he had at the age of 29, when he was diagnosed with schizophrenia and then institutionalized. An Art and America Society exhibition, the first solo show of Bispo do Rosario in the United States, tells the story of the man and his work through a selection of iconic artworks, hand-embroidered textiles, mixed-media sculptures, and an Annunciation garment, his most famous piece that took a lifetime to produce, which he intended to wear on Judgment Day. My colleague Luisa Lemmy spoke with the four curators of the exhibition, Jaime Iglesias Lucan, Ricardo Resenji, Javier Teles, and Chi Jojima. They explained why the Afro-Brazilian artist's work is so important, how it influenced others, and why Bispo do Rosario can make us expand our idea of what art is. Bispo do Rosario, All Existing Materials on Earth, is open in New York City at American Society through May 20th. If you can't make it in person, you can learn more and see the artwork by visiting us at as-coa.org/bispo or check the podcast notes for the link. Thank you for joining us.
You're listening to Latin America in Focus.
Latinoamérica en Foco.
América Latina en Foco.
A podcast by America Society, Council of the Americas, on politics, economics, and culture in the region.
Heitor Bispo do Rosario was born in Sergipe, in the northeast of Brazil, in 1909. He was a strong man who worked as a vulcanizer at Rio de Janeiro's utility company. As a family servant, he joined the Brazilian Navy and was even a professional boxer for a while. But one night, when he was 29, everything changed.
So, Bispo Rosario's story is that he presented himself at a young age of 29 years old to a church claiming that he thought he was the new Messiah. That is when he is taken by the police into the mental health institution where he lived on and off for the rest of his life. He heard voices that he felt were telling him to recreate all the existing materials on earth.
E como é que vai ser essa representação?
A representação é que eu vou estancar, representar um resplendor, e a fim de dizer de apresentação, o mundo, que ele deve de apresentar é os interessados aqui da colônia.
That is why we have that title for the show, which is a sentence that he said in an interview himself.
That was Jaime Iglesias Lucan, director and chief curator at Art at American Society, as well as one of the All Existing Materials on Earth exhibition curators. She explained to me that Bispo do Rosario is considered an outsider artist, a term used to refer to people who are either self-taught or that created their art in a special context. Bispo made more than 1,000 pieces to recreate the universe, all while he was at the Colonia Juliano Moreira Psychiatric Institution in Rio de Janeiro. He spent 50 years of his life hospitalized, and today, the Colonia Juliano Moreira houses the Museum Bispo do Rosario.
In order to do that, he collected objects from all over the Colonia to categorize them, and he also reproduced objects by recreating them with thread and other materials, and he also represented them in the embroideries that he does, in the standardis, but also in the garments that he creates. This was all part for him of this mission to to catalog the world. And in a way, he was trying to create an encyclopedia to present God with everything that he had created and to show him what was going on Earth. So it was, you know, a very beautiful and a very important mission that allowed him to really take upon this job and this creative responsibility so laboriously and so seriously over so many years.
When visitors enter the gallery at American Society, the first thing to see is Bispo's cloak, the most famous piece in the show. It's embroidered with drawings of boats, vehicles, animals and objects, words. It has tassels, braids, and on the inside, one can see Bispo's sewed names all over the garment. It is breathtaking.
The manto is a key piece in Bispo Rosario's production because it is a garment that he created to wear on Judgment Day. He created for himself, he would wear it, and he believed that making the manto was a way to be in better connection with God and to be able to be rightly, you know, evaluated at the time of Judgment Day.
Ricardo Rezende, curator of the exhibition and of Museu Bispo do Rosário in Rio, described the cloak, called by curators the Annunciation Garment, as almost an encyclopedia of Bispo's work.
I describe Bispo's oeuvre as one single work, made of 1,000 pieces. We recently finished cataloging it, and the cloak is interesting because it is recataloging all of that. The cloak is sort of a catalogue raisonné of his oeuvre, a comprehensive guide of his body of work.
Cataloging happens in almost every piece in the exhibition. Nearly all works were embroidered with a reference. I noticed names of countries, Brazilian states and locations, descriptions of objects, occupations, flags and numbers. The curators told me much of the threads used for the embroidery came from hospital gowns. Bispo traded with the nurses at the Colonia. He used sheets from the hospital beds to create his estandartes. Big embroidered fabric pieces where one can see scenes of boats, trains, lists, and patient bodily stains, all in one big story. Javier Teles, a Venezuelan artist who is also a curator of the exhibition, told me Bispo's artwork always will reference one another, as if his reproduction of everything on Earth came with a map to be presented to God. Teles explains that even though Bispo did all that with raw materials, isolated in a cell of a psychiatric hospital, he was not the only one to be producing art as an archive of the world at that time.
I mean, a lot of the ideas, for instance, of Bispo relate to contemporary and modern art, you know. You could see, you know, for instance, the idea of cataloging or the idea of creating an archive, what is being called the archive impulse, is very common practice in the 1960s and even before, you know. Like, I mean, you have many artists like Boltanski, like, you know, Hannah Terboven, that were actually invested on this idea of making lists and making catalogs of things, you know? And this is precisely what Bispo does. So this apparently, you know, distance between so-called outsider art and mainstream art sometimes is relative, you know, because you could see actually that we have the same preoccupations that other people have.
Chie Jojima.
A lot of the times when we read about Bispo's works, he's categorized within the outsider art field or institutionalized artists. But I think that one very important thing that Bispo do Rosário's works invite us to do is to rethink about those categories themselves, you know, because art is something that we decide what art is. And throughout art history, artists, especially in the modern times, artists have always been pushing what art is. And Bispo's works are really inviting us to think how we define those things. Why do we need to put an adjective before his name saying that he's an outsider art? No, he's an artist. And what is the role of institutions in defining that? We need to also think about our biases. Is it because of racial and class issues that come also within, you know, it's also part of his life and part of his practice. Whereas other artists that also had mental health issues, they are not considered as such because they are, I don't know, European or white or this and that. So I think those are important reminders.
Jojima, assistant curator at America Society, also told me about Bispo's process as a reflection on consumer objects and Brazil's modernization throughout the 20th century.
He allows us to think about art institutions that were created in this process of modernization, of mental health institutions that were also created as a result of this process, and also the materials themselves. You see combs and cups and buttons and sandals and all of these consumer objects that he was reflecting on, or even, for instance, ways of entertainment that are very much part of this modernizing process of the country.
Bispo influenced many artists. At his time at the Colonia Hospital, he started to receive visits from established artists in Rio, but never wanted to participate in formal art workshops. When Frederico Moraes, one of the main curators and art historians in Brazil, encountered his work, it amazed the art circles. But Moraes was only able to present a solo show at Bispo do Rosario after the artist's death in 1989. Here's Ricardo Rezende again.
We see this impact on José Leo Nilsson's work, perhaps the best-known artist who was influenced. When he sees Bispo's work in 1990, his own work changes. He starts embroidering, sewing, and using fabrics with more intention. He starts using old rags as canvas on the wall, and he gets this inspiration from Bispo's work.
Elaine May Iglesias-Lukin. He
really is an example of like allowing us to expand what we think when we think about the art system and to be able to be more inclusive in the type of artists that we present in institutions, right? It is interesting in that regard that this is an art institution, right? This is an exhibition space, and Bispo also create his production in another type of institution. So institutions are spaces that allow a discourse, but there are also spaces that can limit the way that we think about a discourse. And with including an artist like Bispo, it allows us to expand that.
Thanks for listening. I'm your host, Karin Zessas. This episode was produced by our executive producer, Luisa Lemmy. You can find links to see images, videos, and access a pocketbook about the exhibition Bispo do Rosario, All Existing Materials on Earth, in the podcast notes. The shows open in New York City at 680 Park Ave through May 20th. The music in this podcast was Sexteto Místico by Heitor Villa-Lobos, performed at America Society. Find out about upcoming concerts at musicoftheamericas.org. We hope you enjoyed this episode. You can help us spread the word. Write us a review, give us 5 stars, or subscribe at Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thank you.